Since I don't have much time and I don't have much so important as what Mr. Siddharth just said, I would keep it short and if need be take a couple of questions. I'm supposed to speak about how to fight a 1,000 crore defamation case because I've been slapped with this case in Bombay High Court by Jet Airways because of my book, A Feast of Vultures, where I have, based on government documents, detailed how Jet Airways and its promoter Naresh Goyal was deeply linked with Dawood Ibrahim and other criminal elements and has used hawala routes and other illegal means to build his empire. So before I talk about how I intend to fight or what I'm doing, I wish I could tell you two lines about if I had 1,000 crores. If I had 1,000 crores, I would give away most of that money to people like Siddharth or others who are doing fearlessly standing up to hold light to powers, standing up, not being intimidated, and in their own ways contributing to improving the democracy that we see. I think there is no way forward for us other than fighting to mature this democracy. And there are very serious challenges when you have the biggest newspaper in the country taking down an article about the president of the ruling party's assets. We should be scared, not just be ashamed. You should be scared because tonight the knock could be at your doorsteps. Not because you are a Muslim or a Christian, but because you are a Hindu also. You could be knocked and you could be picked up. You could be in jail someday. There won't be anyone to ask questions. So if I had 1,000 crores, Siddharth, most of the money will be coming to people like you and to every language. And we will give it away to all the journalists so that we have more journalists standing up courageously to the managements and to the politicians and to everyone else who wants to manipulate the discourse of a human society's progress. So what do you do? I mean, to fight 1,000 crore defamation case is what I'm supposed to speak about. The first thing that you do once you get the court summons, the court documents, is to take a deep breath, because you are nowhere near 1,000 crores. You are not worth it. So you are amazed by the deviousness and the hypocrisy that is there in that very document that has been approved by your country's probably the costliest lawyer, Harish Salve. There is no quantification of how this 1,000 crore has come about, but it is signed off by Harish Salve. So people who sit in the TV studios and give us moral lectures about constitutionalism for a few lakh rupees of fees, they would justify anything in the name of professionalism. And that, my friends, is a big danger in this country. So once you are settled with the realities of the case, and because it's an individual case, I'm accused individually. I'm not Hindu's employee. I'm the author of a book. So I have to defend it myself. So one of the first things that you do is to call out to lawyer friends or people that you know who are standing up for certain values and who are known to be doing helping out journalists and others. So as usual, I landed up with Prashant Bhushan, a one-man institution who is doing more for this country than the entire opposition collectively. And from there, I started my preparation. Look, it brings in anxieties and tensions, but once it is settled down, and once you realize that you don't have the money even to hire lawyers to stand up to Harish Salve, what you use is the goodwill that you have and the friends you have. So I have Prashant Bhushan waiting my documents in Delhi and in Mumbai, Bombay High Court. My lawyer is Advocate Mihir Deshai, who is also fighting Tisa Settlewar's case and all. And these are people who are fighting my case, not for the money that I can offer, but for the values that we are signing up to. And what have I been up to after the case was served on me is that I've actually gone about looking for more documents on the terrorists. And I've been collecting documents on them. And I believe in documents. I if you look at my book, it's backed by about 15,000 documents. I've been collecting more documents from various agencies which detail how almost a criminal syndicate built up Jet Airways. And I'm not singling out Jet. I'm fighting Jet because they filed a case. In fact, if you see my book, it begins in a Bihar village and ends outside Mukesh Ambani's house. And the last chapter, I'm standing outside Ambani's house and wondering when the richest Indian wants to build the world's most expensive home, he couldn't find a piece of land that was clean. It was a land where an orphanage stood until about 15 years ago. So I've not spared anybody. I've not garnished any names. I've not censored anybody. I've named anybody. The only one who's going to court is Jet Airways. And I know the reasons because ever since the case came up, I can see Naresh Goyal is in a great desperation to sell off his remaining stake in Jet Airways, and I've been getting a lot of phone calls from due diligence companies, and there is global concerns. So I've been collecting documents, and yesterday I just returned. I came to Jaipur from Mumbai, and what I've done is to rework my reply. Usually, you know, in a civil defamation case, which Siddhartha and all are very familiar, we usually deny the allegations at the place. So most of the paragraphs will be, I deny, you know, whatever, you know how it is, the lawyers know the game. But what I've done is I'm pushing my lawyers, saying that besides placing the documents backing what is there in the book, I've also told them to seek the court's permission to place on record more documents that are of government agencies. So we are going to be placing a whole lot of parliamentary proceedings, we are going to be placing a whole lot of enforcement directorate and other agencies' secret communications about the criminal links of Naresh Goyal, and I'm going to push at it. I've been approached by intermediaries, various people, to see if I can go slow on the case and all that. I don't intend to. I intend to fight, and I intend to fight in the hope that Indian judiciary will has great values, and I have to have that very childlike belief in the goodness of judiciary. And I intend to fight, and I do not intend to compromise. And while I have taken such a stand, it's pertinent to mention that, you know, besides me, there is my publisher, which is Rupert Murdoch Company, HarperCollins, and there is a couple of other media houses who publish the extracts and all that also accuse. One of those media houses has actually gone to court, filed a response, and has not even shared it with me. In the response, they have offered to publish any rejoinder that Jet gives. And they place the blame on me, which I can understand because it's my book's extract. But that's the times that we are living in. We are living in times where media owners are already apologizing to anyone who is powerful. And it's left to individuals like maybe Siddharth or me, I mean, you know, some of us to stand up. But I intend to stand up, and I intend to fight, and I do not intend to go in for any kind of compromise from my side. Thank you. If there is any quick questions, otherwise.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, there are many young journalists here and aspiring journalists. If you can tell them about something about investigative journalism, practical reality of investigative journalism. See, we are living in some dreams of journalism, like journalism is a very limelight profession. So you can give some tips regarding investigative journalism. How to start, how to make contacts, how to get the content.
Actually, there is nothing called investigative journalism. Actually, there are only two kinds of journalism. One is good journalism and other is a bad journalism. And bad journalism, you can see enough of them on television, which is now no more journalism. It's entertainment that you see. Entertainment of the very devious and criminal kind. Good journalism is more like academics to me. That's what I practice. I enjoy documents. I collect documents on everything that I write. I do not use hidden cameras or hidden recordings. I think journalism is a very dignified profession, which has come to a very bad state in this country. And I think as young journalists, I hope some of you will stand up and say that you will not at least work for those horrendous channels who are creating communal divide and who are churning out fake news, because I hope that's where good journalism begins. It's within the individual, you know. Both excellence and morality are very lonely pursuits. You cannot do it in a group. I have to tell myself that I'm not going to take somebody's bribe. I'm not going to listen to somebody else. I will stand and fight, right? So I hope all of you stand up and fight. And from that value commitments, everything else will flow. And investigative journalism, if there is something like that, it is all about backing up every word that you're going to write.
From what I understand, you're still working with the Hindu, right? So, in the case that this case has been filed against you, are they sort of helpless in that scenario to do anything to help you with this? Are you left to defend the entire case on your own?
So, you know, as you grow mature in this profession, and having received, I've received something like 50, 60 defamation threats and several privilege notices. So, I'm used to it. I'm also used not to go out and seek help unless it's offered to me, and unless it's necessary. So I haven't had a conversation like that with my owners, and I don't expect my editor or Hindu to come and back me for something that I've been working for 10 years. It's a book that I've written, and I've written that book with all the responsibility. And mind you, it's not just, you're talking about Hindu. I've also absolved Harper Collins of any legal cost. So I've taken responsibility in writing.
All right, sir. And second question, from what I understood from the last statement you made, do you genuinely see sting journalism as it exists in its current definition as part of investigative journalism?
No,
or
I don't.
You don't?
I think sting journalism has its place, and there are unavoidable necessities sometimes. But what is being practiced in this country as sting journalism and Google search are both very lazy journalisms, and I think no hidden camera can replace the integrity of cultivating trust and winning over people's faith and giving them the confidence to hand over sensitive files to you.
Sir, I have a question actually. I do not have much access to what journalist and how do you work out in depth as such. But my question is a bit general. Apart from investigating journalism, as you mentioned, that is your forte as such. But my question is to you as well as to Siddharth as well. In these times of cynicism, how do you maintain impartiality? How do you ensure that you do not become a tool in hands of people who are working against the establishment? I'm of the, if I can elaborate my question, just to give a perspective actually, I'm of the opinion that establishment has to be questioned. That's a set norm in democracy. Whosoever is in power, BJP is in power, Congress is in power, Aam Aadmi Party is in power, whosoever is in power, he is accountable to people of India. And that is why establishment, whosoever is in establishment, establishment deserves to be questioned. But how do you ensure to remain absolutely impartial? Because I am very concerned, as you named so many individuals who are actually attached to a set ideology, who are actually not working against establishment, they are working against a particular ideology. So how do you ensure, being a journalist, whether you or whether Siddharth, who was really, really working as crusaders, yeah, how do you ensure that you do not become tools in hands of just to embarrass the government?
So, you know, there is not, it's not a rocket science. Actually, this entire business of journalism is a very mediocre affair. We are not doctors or anything. I'm sure Siddharth also agrees, our default position is adversarial. Whoever is in power, my job is not to be their PR. They've got PIB and other government PR agencies, and these days all the trolls out there to propagate their business. My job is to question the establishment for what wrong they do. So I have a default adversarial role for last 20 years, 25 years. So when UPA 2 was in power, it was, if you go back and look at my byline, it's under my byline some of the biggest scandals were written, whether it's Aadhaar's housing scam or Commonwealth Games or 2G or a lot of them. So I am just carrying on with my default position. Now, about somebody misusing me, that's a question. So every day I keep, almost every second I keep getting documents from anonymous sources, political agents, various kinds of people. But I have my own certain, professional rules to verify. So if I get a government document from a third party, not from the official who's handling it, and if I can't verify it myself, I don't touch it. Because of which a very famous minister of the present government hates me, because he is a master of sending documents to offices. So when I was in Times of India, I would keep telling my bosses I won't touch it because I can't verify it, right? So that's a professional thing. I don't, and mind you, if you want to play role of a journalist, not as a propagandist, and to be adversarial, then you can't be thinking like a politician that am I popular or not. I'm not. I should be the least popular man on this earth. Because I am standing up and speaking against the majoritarian bullshit that's going around, right? So I don't want your popularity. Do you agree with my facts? You may not. I've been called an ISI agent when Kargil war was going on, but it took 10 days for the army to accept that what I said was right. So I've gone through that. I've been asked to apologize to parliament for breach of privilege. I said, no, I haven't breached your privilege. You put me to jail. So I'm saying that it is a process that goes on. This is nothing new. What's happening today is, unfortunately, some of those famous television journalists and other journalists who used to call me up early morning asking for documents of the story that I've done and would flash it on channels, are today, they haven't called me for the last 3 years. And mind you, they will call me back in 2 years, 3 years down the line when this government goes down or when their fortunes change. I'm not in that business. If my story doesn't go through, I'll keep quiet. I have a folder in my Gmail called The Morgue, which is a mortuary of my dead stories. I'll keep storing it there. I will bring it out. If Indian media doesn't publish it, I will help the foreign media to publish it. Wherever it is, the facts needs to come out, because ultimately, every corruption, whether it is the perfumed oil that our rulers buy for their daily baths, or whether it is the designer dress or the chashma that they use, or the other kind of money that they splurge, everything is snatching away the bread from the poor. And I don't think I need to be much bothered about being accused of being manipulated.
Yes. Sir, so those of us who understand what you do have a tendency to romanticize what you do, because we understand what you're doing is a very big thing to do without knowing the other side. So I just want you to tell us, what is the personal cost at which you do what you do in terms of time, effort, and of course money, and what still makes it worth doing?
I'm not surprised with your question, because wherever I go this is a question, and I have seen n number of journalists doing one big story and then for a lifetime talking about that one story. I don't intend to do that. So I would love to be the fly on the wall. I want to do the next story. So I don't want to discuss any specifics, but you can imagine if your story is costing huge financial loss to corporations, or costing some politician his seat or his power, then it will have its implications. That's part of the job. But then, mind you, being a journalist in Delhi, I also drive my car, you know, myself. So actually, as a driver, I'm at a higher risk of losing life than as a journalist, because average 5 people get killed on Delhi roads on a day. So I have a safe job, and so I think we should discuss that part. Now I'll reverse the question. Look at it this way: even if somebody who knows me in power, and if I call him up, he knows that the beggar needs to pick up the phone, otherwise he's going to have it, right? So I enjoy that power. I should not be discussing that, because it has its own other more romanticization that goes into it, which will ruin all of us. Thank you.